Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone. Today we're actually going to be talking about belief and faith in angels. Now, we know that they're creatures that are made of light and they have specific duties, but at many times we see that a lot of Muslims are really not finding the link between themselves and angels. So what is really the main reason? How do we actually look at those links between, or at least in our faith, between our iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and our iman in the malaika? What is the link? What is that connection? Now, when we're talking about the iman or faith in the malaika, just really quick, when we're talking about the malaika, we're looking at a number of different things about the malaika. Number one is that you're looking at malaika that are different creatures than human creatures, in where malaika don't eat or drink. Malaika, they have a different relationship with the world than we as humans. And the malaika, of course, they don't reproduce. Malaika are made of light. But here's the thing, is that, so what does that have to do with us as human beings and with our faith? So that's why we're actually going to talk about certain things. Now, with the malaika, yes, indeed, they do certain duties, like the tasbih. They will engage in salah. They have specific duties. They have a specific relationship between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is really important to talk about, because when we're talking about the link between malaika and human beings, we're actually talking about a link between man and ghaib, meaning the world of the unseen. What are we actually talking about here, and how is that even important, or holding at any importance? That's what we're going to be talking about today, inshallah. But before we actually talk about that, it's really important to look at a number of different categories. Because when we're looking at the category in the creatures around us, we're seeing the first category as the animals, those creatures that pretty much eat, drink, reproduce, and really don't have a purpose in life. They don't have a purpose in life. The humans, on the other hand, they've got one purpose, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what does it mean? So the animals and the human beings share one important behavior, which is that they eat, they drink, and reproduce, and even have the urge. But for animals, that urge is what keeps them alive. If it wasn't for that urge, they would not have stayed alive. But for the humans, yes, the urge to eat, drink, and reproduce is an urge, but yes, is it a need and a want compared to animals? Because for the animals, it's a need and a want. That's why they'll keep on eating. They won't necessarily stop, or at least not as humans. The tools for the animals, for them, is really the tools to keep them in survival, in where they've got the different shelters, they've got the different things to keep them really in a survival mode. But for humans, because their reason, in other words, their purpose of life, is not just for survival mode, because the survival mode is a tool and is not necessarily the purpose, which is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave man the fitrah, the instinct, and that instinct is different than the animal instinct, the instinct to question life, the instinct to feel that there is an essence behind life. Man was given, unlike the animals, the mind, the intellect, to think beyond their own creation, to think beyond the materialistic side, which is eating, drinking, and reproduction. The other part, which is the body, and the ability that the body has, at least the human body, is totally different than the animal body, which is pretty much given a certain specific purpose. It completes a certain specific task, and that's the end of the body for the animals. Compared to the body within the human body, it actually has a multifunction capabilities, a number of different capacities to complete certain tasks. But there's no way that we can know this task and we can know the essence for life unless we actually get some message. And this message was actually sent with the Malaika. Here's one thing. It often is a question that people ask. So why do Muslims fast? Why do we fast? Why do we engage in any type of a worship or spiritual connection at all? Most of the times, people would answer the question and say, well, we fast in order to feel with the poor. But that's not really the case. If that was really the reason, then do we abstain from any sexual relations during fasting to feel with those that are not married? Absolutely not. If we actually look at this diagram, we could see a certain pattern with the angels. They don't eat, they don't drink, they don't reproduce. But on the other hand, they also have, for their body capacities, for their physical abilities, they are made of light, they fly, they reshape, they're strong, they're organized, they do a specific job, they perform all tasks to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they only do one task, which is obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how is the human different from an angel? For the angels, they don't have the intellect that you have, which is why during the ayah, or in the ayah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked the malaika, told the malaika that he was going to create a creature, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them about the creature and then tested them with their knowledge. But all they said was, Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana. Subhanaka, all glory be to you. We don't know unless you teach us. Telling us and hinting to us that the malaika don't necessarily have the intellect that humans do. Why do the humans have the intellect? Well, that's the main place for putting them for the test. In order to be tested, you need the free will and you need the ability to make a decision. You need the ability to actually decide to do something or to abstain from it. And that's what keeps that test there. Now, for the malaika, on the other hand, they're not tested. So what do we understand from this? But they both have the same goal, the same purpose, the same duty that they have to live and abide by, which is to worship and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here's one thing. So what is the link between humans, animals, and angels? When we look at the link, we see that the humans, they share with animals certain things. But we could see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was always organizing or regulating, to be more specific, regulating certain things in the human, in our human creation, in our human urges, in order to elevate from the level of being animals, in where we would have no purpose in life, to elevate us to live like the malaika, or at least share with the malaika certain things, which is to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the difference is that for humans, if they actually live up to that principle, they are actually elevated even higher. Where did we get that? Well, we got that from where the connection between the humans and the angels, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually tells us, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. The story actually begins there, between the angels and the humans. The story begins where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually orders the malaika to prostrate for Adam, to make sujood for Adam. Why make sujood for Adam? It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's order. But here's one thing, is that you could see that the malaika themselves were being tested to do sujood for Adam. But there are other reports where if that believer actually lives up to the words and up to the principles of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they're even closer, that they actually get a higher rank. Why? Because they were tested with their free will. Unlike the malaika that don't have free will, all they are able to do is only obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, we could see that the beginning between the connections between humans and angels actually started before even our birth. It actually started with Adam alayhi salam. So what is the link? Well, the link is, one, is that closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually based on your obedience to Allah himself. Now, what does that mean? We go to the second part of it, in where in the second connection in human life, in where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually sends the malaika when the woman is pregnant with her own child. In the second coming, let me call it that way, you could see that the malaika, the Prophet ﷺ actually mentioned in the hadith, إن أحدكم يجمع خلقه في بطن أمه 40 يوم النطفة, that there for 40 days they are in a nutfa, they're in a state of a sperm, or in a state of, in the beginning of their stages. The stages, they grow in their stages, they grow in their creation, but then a close contact between them and the malaika happens again. In this close contact, the malaika are actually doing a specific job, and that job is to actually write the main four and most important stages in that person's life. Stage number one is that to write their rizq, to write all the different rizq that they will get, all the different things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless them with. The other part, which is the limit for their lifespan. The other part, which is their action. What type of behavior, what type of ending is this person going to live up to? How are they going to apply the principle? Now, which if you actually look at these different sides to it, we're talking about the different potentials that they will be given, which is the rizq. It could be wealth, it could be marriage, it could be intelligence, it could be all these different rizq. And the other part, which is the lifespan. In other words, that you get, your life actually has potentials, but there's also a limit to the potentials, including the potential of life. But there's the one and the most important reason for those potentials, which is actually mentioned, it's the action. Are they able to live up to the action? Now, again, when you look at that second connection with the malaika, it's actually related to, one, yes, there's a physical connection, but two, there's the connection between man and the world of the unseen. The connection between man and the world of unseen is actually related to the most important stages in human life. The most important stages in human life is the beginning of their own life, the ending of their life, and in between those times, which acts as the pivotal and most important reason for their creation, which is the test itself, the behavior itself. What are you living up to? Now, when we look at those different stages, we can actually see that there is this connection between man and the unseen before man was created, as in the story of Adam and Al-Malaika. But then there's the story where his own creation actually connects with an angel that comes to him before he was even born, while he is in the beginning of his stages of creation. Now, what we could see in those different stages is that there is a connection, and that connection is more important between a human being and the materialistic life that they are living, and that there is a more important connection in their life to live up to, which is the connection of living even higher and more important than the life, the materialistic life. In other words, more important than the surface of your own creation. In fact, your own essence in life is actually decided before your own life. Your essence of life actually begins before life, before your creation. Before your creation, in other words, before humankind, mankind creation on earth, and before your own specific creation as a human being, as yourself, to be created, you've got to create a relationship between you and the unseen. That your life is more than just the materialistic side of life in where eating and drinking, but there is that connection between you and living up to the principle to believe and actually feel the unseen, which is more important and which is a lot more expansive, which is a lot more abundant than actually the materialistic life that you see. In fact, there are more malaika than other materialistic creations that you see, and materialistic creatures. Materialistic in that what you sense, animals, trees, all these different things. There are more of the unseen creatures than from the seen creatures. There are more jinn, there are more malaika, there are more shayateen than there are actually from the seen creatures, from the seen materialistic creatures that you see. Now, what we don't recognize as human beings is that we only think that life is just matter in motion. But the whole thing about our own creation is to connect us with that alam al-ghaib. In the first level of faith in Islam is that, yes, you believe using your mind, using your intellect, that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah. You perform certain actions, the actions in where you're doing zakah, you're doing salah, you're performing siyam, etc. All these different things. But that is still more of a mental, that is still the beginning of the level of your connection between Allah Almighty and your connection between your life and trying to figure out your path. But here's one thing. If you look at it in the second stage of faith, which is the stage of Iman, in the second stage of Iman, it is all about faith in something in the unseen. Whether it's belief in Allah Almighty, the belief in the angels, the belief in the books that he had sent, the belief in the prophets that you had never seen yourself, the belief in Judgment Day, which of course you have no connection to, all these different sides, and even the decree, and that there's some kind of a precedent or some knowledge about your own future, about your own creation that even preceded your own creation. We could see that all those different sides are actually part of the unseen. Where it's connected with the unseen is actually teaching us that there is another stage of understanding. Here's the point, of understanding yourself, your creation as a human being, and the world that you live in. That the world you live in is farther than your mental understanding, your intellectual understanding of the world. Once you grow in your faith, that is when you start realizing that this world actually has more to it than the surface of the creation. The more you grow in your faith, the more you're able to recognize that this world actually has the ghaib in it, the unseen. But the connection with the ghaib is not just to know about it, is not just to believe in it. And this actually takes us to the second stage of connection between humans and angels. In the second connection between humans and angels, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually mentions a number of different things where there could be a specific or a general connection between you and the angels. It's another type of a connection. The connections in where the presence, the angel's presence, is actually part of increasing the blessing or increasing the connection between you and the essence of your life. What is the essence of your life? The essence of your life is actually the essence that was decided by Allah Almighty before even the creation of Adam and before the creation of your own self as even an uncreated human or a child yet. Now, when we look at those two essences, there's an essence for life in general, and there's an essence that you as a human being live up to, which is living up to the essence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had actually pre-decreed in this life. Now, and that's where, when you look at the connection There are certain things in where the malaika will actually be present to aid you in living up to that essence. Now, there is a general relationship, that general relationship in where one, human protection. There's always the malaika to give you that human protection. There's always the malaika to deliver or actually deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as with the ruh, as with Jibreel alayhi salam, and also how Jibreel alayhi salam taught the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam not only the Quran, but even how to perform wudu, how to perform salah, etc. All these different things, or even the ending of life, or even the ending of life, when it also when we're looking at the ayah, قُلْ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي وُكِّلَ بِكُمْ. There's a certain angel that comes to actually, in other words, take the soul of that person. But there's also recording the human action. When we're looking at recording the human action, there's a specific angel that is actually there with you all the time, just recording your action. But there's also reminding man of what is good. When we're looking at reminding man of what is good, this is actually taking us to another level. When we're talking about reminding man of what is good, there's a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually says that there is one jinn from the shayateen, of course, that is a qarina, that is always with us. And there's also one malaika that is always with us. The jinn or the shayateen that are with us are actually ordering us to do what is evil. The malaika, on the other hand, is excited and always encouraging you to do what is good. Now, we could see that they're always there, but when we look at those ones that are recording, that's a general relationship. The presence of the malaika is really important because their presence actually enhances your relationship between you and the ghaib. Your relationship with the malaika enhances your relationship between you and the essence that you were created for before even your creation. Again, think of the essence as the two categories that I had mentioned. So we could see in the hadith where the shaitan is saying, ikhtim bishar, like end your day in evil, and will actually tell the human being not to do what is right. On the other hand, the malaika are there and actually saying, "Iftah bi khair," start your day with good, start your day with dhikr, start your day with something with living up to the principle. All those different sides are actually telling us that there are specific relationships in where there so a general relationship and there's a specific relationship. There's a specific relationship between between man and the malaika in where to enhance that essence again, which is the connection between you and ghaib, between you and the unseen, between you and what is even more important than the materialistic life. There are certain times that the malaika will join. There are certain places, there are certain actions that the malaika will be there. Why? Really, to enhance your relationship between you and the essence and the world of ghaib due to time. There are certain times that the malaika will be present in, such as Laylat al-Qadr, and where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually says, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالرُّوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ, that during that day, that there are malaika that will actually come down for what? To do one, engage in the ibadah with the believers, and to bless that day and even be with the mu'mineen at that time. There's also the time of death for the salihin, where they will actually be there, just like as in Surah Al-Fajr, where they will cry out, يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةُ ارْجِعِي إِلَىٰ رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَّةً, where they will even witness the souls and the spirits, the souls of the salihin, and actually make dua for them. ارْجِعِي إِلَىٰ رَبِّكِ رَاضِيَةً مَرْضِيَّةً, go back to your Lord content and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is content, is also content over you. You could see all those sides in where the relationship between man to arise, to go beyond the materialistic, the surface of a materialistic life, and to actually go beyond living up to the essence and connecting with what is even a bigger life, which is the unseen. What is the unseen? Whether one, the unseen to mean al-akhirah, the unseen to mean the Jannah, the unseen to mean Allah on top of all, the unseen to mean the essence that you were created for. All those different things, the essence, which is what is put in one word, al-qadar. All these different unseens, the malaika, are the ones to do that transition, are the ones to decide or even to organize and regulate those different sides. And their presence itself is actually a blessing. The malaika will only be present during the times, and I'm talking about the specific malaika, because they're malaika that never depart, that never leave you, no matter where and when you are. When we're talking about when, I mean, in other words, they're with you. Even if you enter the bathroom, those malaika are the general malaika that are writing your actions. But the specific malaika that are there in order to enhance your relationship between you and the unseen, between you and Allah, between you and the essence, are actually those specific malaika that are the ones that only come down for specific cases, with a specific duty, with a specific mission. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا. Those that will say, تَتَنَزَّلُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, that will say Allah is our Lord Almighty, ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا, and live up to that level of essence, the principle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had regulated, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had considered as justice. تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ, the malaika would actually come to them regularly. تَتَنَزَّلُ is like regularly coming down to them. أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. What are they doing? They're actually giving a message. The message is not heard. The message is not something that you can hear, but is a message of a certain inspiration, of a message that you will feel, but not necessarily here. In other words, when we're looking at a connection between you and the malaika, it is different than the connection between you and human beings. The connection between you and human beings, there's a specific way of communicating between you and human beings. Communication through dialogue, through talking, verbal, etc. But the connection and the communication between man and the malaika, and specifically the salihin, once they live up to that principle, then they're able to hold a different kind of a communication. That communication is giving a spiritual support. The spiritual support in where they're telling them, La alla takhafu, don't feel the fear. In other words, the opposite of fear is feeling content, is feeling stable, is feeling that stability, that feeling of connection, and not feeling of disconnection. When does fear happen? The fear happens when you are disconnected from your understanding of your own time and place. When you are lost, you're afraid. You're afraid because your understanding of place and where you are is there. Your understanding of where you are, when it's gone, that's when you start feeling the fear. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the malaika to the salihin to tell them, Allah takhafu. It's a different kind of a communication. It's a communication where it goes beyond the materialistic kind of a communication. Our understanding of communication is very limited when we actually think of communication happening with phones or happening with verbal talking, etc. That connection is very shallow in its understanding of communication. The communication that happens between the mu'mineen and the malaika is a communication that goes through ghaib, that goes through the unseen, that communication to bring in a different kind, and even has an effect even on feelings. The feelings of not feeling fear and feeling stable and feeling content. ولا تحزنوا, and don't feel sorrow and don't be sad, which actually would connect us with our times today. And when we're talking about the increase of depression, I'm not saying every single depression diagnosis necessarily relating to somebody being absent or even being absent from Allah or being away from Allah. But one thing is that what will increase and enhance your feeling of feeling more content and satisfaction and being separated or at least being distant from depression is actually one form in Islam where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that two things, being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in faith, and the other part, putting that faith into action, which is as indicated in the word istaqamu, where they live up to it, and that brings in the malaika to bring in that inner content. The connection between man and the malaika, or let me call it the communication between man and malaika, between man and angels, there's a certain communication, there's a certain dialogue that is not within the materialistic type of dialogue. But it actually goes farther, in where there's a specific dialogue, specific communication between the mu'mineen and the malaika. Tell them, وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا, don't feel the sorrow. In other words, be strong. In other words, despite all the different things that you might encounter in life, hang in there. But in order to get the connection between man and that communication between man and malaika, the malaika are there to give the support for the human beings in order to keep them closely connected between them and the essence. Again, we're going to repeat this word several times, between man and essence, between man and ghaib. The malaika are to actually enhance that relationship between man and essence, between man and ghaib. Why essence and ghaib? Because al-khawf, fear, actually happens when man loses his connection with the essence and the reason for his creation. You start feeling fear. Why am I here? What am I supposed to be doing? Then what? But then the sorrow and the sadness actually happens when man loses his connection between himself and the unseen, between himself and the presence, his own life, time, place. Where am I heading to? Time. My father died. My mother died. Then what? What is happening after that? Then what? This is the reason for sorrow. Sorrow is usually related to past. Sorrow is usually related to time in history that we live in, where it's something probably that happened to us in the past and we sometimes don't understand how to get out of it. The trauma will still affect us, but when the person actually has the connection between them and understanding essence, in understanding the reason for their time, and that this time is limited, but it is from this narrow life to the grand and the vastness of the akhirah, their feeling of the essence, their feeling of their own creation is totally different. And that's why when we look at an iman, when we look at faith in the malaika, there's a different kind of a connection. Where? There's a different kind where due an increase in action, you increase the connection between you and the malaika. Let me change a word. It will also increase the communication between you and the malaika. The communication in where the malaika will not only speak to the Salihin, but will actually go farther and actually love the Salihin. Sorry, I lost the, will actually love the Salihin, in where the hadith actually says, in where the mala'ik, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell them, I love X or Y, love him. And they will love that person. There's a love, there's a communication. Now, when we speak about communication, we usually think of completing a certain task, which is why a lot of the atheists struggle to explain feelings. How do we understand feelings? Are they part of our materialistic creation, or are they beyond? How do we understand feelings? How do we understand something that we can't necessarily touch, but we feel it? We feel fear, we fear love, we fear hate, we feel all these feelings, but that's a communication between us and the world around us. But there's another communication that goes beyond the materialistic creation, the love that even the malaika will have to you. The malaika, when they have that love to you, it's a different kind of a communication. When a husband loves a wife, or when the mother loves the children, or the father loves his children, that's a different kind of communication that goes beyond our feelings, beyond our senses, where we even feel it. We even feel the connection. And it actually affects our feelings. It actually affects our own behavior. All those different sides of the feelings, communication is actually one link. In where the malaika will even make the dua for the believers, and where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هو الذي يصلي عليكم وملائكته ليخرجكم من الظلمات إلى النور, that the malaika will make the dua, will actually, because they love a person, they will actually ask Allah Almighty to forgive them. They will not only ask Allah Almighty to forgive them, but they will even make the dua on behalf of the believer himself and actually ask Allah Almighty to increase and elevate his level. Not only that, when we look at, so why is that even important? لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. The word لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, it is in order to tell us, the word لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ, لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ means to take you out, to exit you, to get you out, مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, from darkness to light. What darkness? From believing that there is a very limited vision in this world, to actually seeing beyond the materialistic side of your world, which is knowing. When you have light, you're able to see more than when it's dark. When it's dark, your vision is definitely and completely limited to how much you're able to see. Your understanding of your own creation, your understanding of life, your understanding of what is surrounding you is very limited. But when there is light, but there's no way that you can get light without guidance. There's no way that you can get light without guidance, because your only capacity as a human being to understand the world around you is really limited. But you only can understand what is surrounding you only if you get something that is beyond your materialistic touch. Again, your materialistic touch, in other words, your understanding of the world to depend on your senses, your senses is really limited. Your understanding, your senses are limited, therefore your understanding of the world is going to be limited. Your only way to understand beyond your materialistic senses and beyond what your body cannot and does not have the tools to understand, can only be done through ruh, can only be done through your own spirit, your own soul. And that soul and spirit is actually through guidance, how you recognize it, which is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the anbiya with. But the Anbiya sent with the Anbiya were sent with more knowledge and more understanding of what you really are living in this, in what you're really living in this world for, and what really surrounds you. And that's why لِيُخْرِجَكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, where he, the Malaika, are there to also, their presence is also there to help you exit from darkness to light, to exit from not understanding what surrounds you to seeing beyond what is actually there, to from living from the dhulumat, from the darkness of life, the narrowness of your understanding of purpose, to understanding the guidance and more aware of what Noor and what your life really is for. In other words, understanding the essence. That's why Dhulumat actually comes with misguidance, and Noor comes with guidance. So the whole thing about the Malaika is really to give us that support. And you cannot separate the Malaika from the link between you and essence, and between you and your surrounding itself, in where the Malaika themselves would actually make the dua. That dua, when the person, there are certain actions, when the person, for example, is doing their salah, if they don't get up right away, as long as they're sitting down for salah, making their dhikr, the Malaika are present. Certain actions may bring the Malaika, visiting the sick, making Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, in where you're connecting yourself with the Prophet, and you're connecting yourself with the Prophet when you're saying that, you're connecting yourself with the unseen, you're connecting yourself with the ghaib, completing the gaps and making salah in jama'ah, salat al-jama'ah, saying ameen when making dua, pious deeds, and every single pious deed that you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will get you closer, and the Malaika will also be present for that. In fact, there's a hadith that is actually authentic, where a man was visiting a friend, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends an angel to ask him, what makes you go to that friend? And he says, well, it's just my love for the sake of Allah to this person. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lets the malaik say, and Allah Almighty loves you as you love your friend for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why did he send that? Because that man loved that other friend for more than a materialistic reason. It wasn't a materialistic reason. The only connection between him and his friend is actually the essence, the love for Allah Almighty. Because the love for Allah Almighty is the connection between X and Y people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring in the Malaika to actually love them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also love X or Y because their connection went beyond the materialistic understanding of life to living up to the essence. The other part, bringing glad tidings to the believers. When one might look into the world, the materialistic things, the believers went to live up to the essence, in where they went for jihad. They put their life on the spot. They put their wealth on the spot. They gave up all the materialistic things because they connected themselves with the ghaib, with the essence. When they connected themselves with the ghaib, when they connected themselves with the essence, that brings in the Malaika to also be there and even join. Even if it's a battle, they will even be there attending the burial, just as they attended the birth. Or at least before even they were created, the Malaika were coming in. They will even attend the burial of the Salihin. The burial of the Salihin, they will be there to attend, to bring in the barakah, because it is one connection. in the materialistic understanding and in the new atheist understanding of life, that you're just a matter in motion, and where you are born and then your ending actually ends with you decomposing. That's the end of life. For the mu'mineen, no, life goes beyond that, to the point that even the malaika will be there to what? To actually celebrate. They were there celebrating for the burial of the salihin. They were there to celebrate that these people ended their life going to Jannah. They will be there to celebrate and attend the burial during reading Quran, in where your connection between you and the malaika, again, you and the essence, actually comes when you're reading Quran as well, or learning Islam and being there, in where the Prophet ﷺ actually says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has malaika. Their main job, their main mission is to roam around in different areas in search of groups, different groups making dhikr, different groups connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, connecting with the essence, connecting with what is beyond the materialistic life. And what are they doing? The malaika would actually sit there. فَإِذَا وَجَدُوا مَجْلِسًا فِيهِ ذِكْرٌ قَاعَدُوا مَعَهُمْ. If they find any setting where there is a connection between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it could be dhikr, it could be la ilaha illallah, it could be subhanallah, it could be alhamdulillah, or a gathering where they were learning Islam, the malaika will actually sit and gather with them. The malaika will bless the gathering, and the malaika will actually come for those gatherings, because it's a gathering where even the malaika will communicate with them, to the point where the malaika will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. But they will say, we were with the group of people, and this is what they were doing. They were making dua, or they were making dhikr, or this is what they were doing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what they were doing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond that, now you are witnesses that I have forgiven them. Now they will say, but there was X or Y that was with them that were actually sinners. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will actually says that غفرت, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala غفر له, or غفرت له غفرت, that I had forgiven him as well, because those people لا يشقى بهم جليسهم, those groups of people, those types of people, their company itself is actually a blessing, that even if the person is with them, in other words, company the salihin and company the malaika. The malaika will company the salihin, and just even if you are a sinner, company the salihin, and you will get the blessing of a salihin. Do salihin have blessings too? The salihin have blessings, and the malaika are actually the ones to bless the salihin. The malaika get the blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the malaika are in the areas that are actually blessed. Even the salihin are actually there getting from the malaika. Now, what is the effect of an angel presence? Remember, get you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to get you to the guidance and light. Now, there are so many different things when we talk about the malaika, but it's just half an hour dars, but I couldn't stop. I guess I just enjoyed, hopefully, inshallah, the presence of the malaika. What brings the angels, and what keeps the angels away? What keeps the angels away is it can actually be understood from what brings the angels, keeping away from sin. Meaning, if you actually sin, that is going to keep the angels away. The places of sin is not the place where you will find the malaika present. Subhanallah, I was one time invited to a wedding. I think I mentioned this before. I was invited to a wedding, and parked a car, took my kids, went into what is supposed to be the hall where the wedding was supposed to be at. Just when about to enter the hall, some guys were standing on the doorway, and they said, no, ma'am, you can't enter here. And I said, but I'm invited to the wedding. I thought that they were guards. They're just standing, two guys, you know, dressed in their normal clothes. And they said, no, ma'am, this is not a place where you can enter. I personally thought it was some kind of an Islamophobic reaction. And they said, no, ma'am, you don't belong here. And I said, but I'm invited to the wedding. And they said, no, ma'am, it's probably our different address. There's no way that you are belonging in this area. And I said, so what is this place? They said, this is a nightclub. I didn't know what that place was. It turned out that the hall was actually on the other side of the place, but I didn't know what it was. But subhanAllah, even those men that were not Muslim, they were understanding that a person dressed in that way does not belong in a place of sin. That's why they just said, you don't belong here. And that's the same thing. SubhanAllah, if a person that is not Muslim was able to identify where a salih person, I'm not saying I'm saliha, but at least to what they saw in appearance, at least dressed in that way, that they don't belong in those areas. Same thing. The malaika will only be present in areas of salah, masajid, probably halaqat dhikr, or probably a place where people are gathered to do righteous things. Angels are also harmed by what harms mankind. It could be a smell, or it could even be bad action. Those things malaika will stay away from. In other words, on the other hand, malaika will actually be present in areas where it will gather good people. Those people that are in bond, in a strong bond, in the essence, on the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're actually bonding, they're actually connecting. On what? On their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is beyond materialistic relations. Angels avoid areas that have sculptures, dogs, music, and sin. Now, dogs have a different story, but I want to look at the issue of music and sin and sculptures, and where, because sculptures for many years, they were used as that figure to resemble some kind of a different deity. So that's why the malaika avoid that, because its connection with a lot of how many they disconnected themselves with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and made those sculptures. So the malaika avoid areas of sculptures and avoid areas where there's that music and that sin and that lifestyle, because it's a materialistic lifestyle and they are beings of the unseen. They are beings of essence and not beings of materialism. Now, angels avoid certain areas where there's even things such as even a bad smell. Now remember, when we're talking about smell, this is actually telling us that not only a smell, but this is telling us that even these things that might disturb, even if it's a smell, such as garlic, it doesn't mean don't do your biryani with onions and don't do your, you know, your chicken karahi and all these different things. No, that doesn't mean stay away from these foods. But this is just to give us that hint that when you go to the areas of the malaika, make sure that what you eat and what you drink and what you put on the inside, make sure it is angel friendly. In other words, reliving that communication, the whole idea of the malaika is reliving the communication between you and the unseen, reliving the communication between you and life, between you and the unseen, between you and the essence of your life. That's the whole concept of malaika. It is redefining your life from a materialistic and a shallow surface of life to living the connection between you and Allah, between you and the essence of life that actually happened between your own creation and between you and the essence, which is al-akhirah. Malaika join all those together. When you're connecting with the malaika, you're actually making a communication between you, the essence, Allah, and the purpose of your own life and even your akhirah. That's why even the connection, the communication between the prophets and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was through Jibreel alayhi salam. The malaika are that trend, that line, that link between you and Allah, between you and the ghaib. Jazakumullah khairan, everyone, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them, inshallah. So if you want to write any questions, if not, we'll end right here. Jazakumullah khairan, everyone, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and barakallahu fikum for attending.